Hello. So I am Dr. Joyce Sherpa, and welcome to Chem 106, Biochemistry, the Molecules of Life. And I'm going to share my screen now so you won't see my face. For those of you who've been with me before in Chem 104 or Chem 104 and 105, the question Joey just asked me was, where are the notes? Don't you post notes? And I remember every term that I teach Chem 106, my students who've had me before ask that. I use PowerPoint this term, and you'll be taking your own notes. So stop me and go get notebook paper and a pencil, and I will tell you when you need to start taking notes. All right, here we go. All right, so biochemistry is the study of the molecules of life. And that's what my doctorate is in from Duke University. And so there's a picture of me because I didn't realize we would see a picture of me live before that. And we're gonna walk through the four main groups, which are carbohydrates. That's what we'll be talking about this week. So going from monomers, which is this, the glucose, to starch, putting it together, all these hexagons, and you're gonna learn how to draw hexagons in this next hour. And this is a cell membrane, which is made up of lipids and all these little squigglies. You're gonna get really good at drawing those next week. In week two, those are fatty acids. So we'll be looking at fats and lipids. And then we move into proteins. So these blue and yellow and red, the channels and the transporters, those are proteins. Proteins are large molecules and just really beautiful and amazing things. And this molecule, many of you probably all know, this is DNA. And I love this video of it, this little GIF, because it shows there's pentagons in there. And we're gonna be drawing pentagons today also. So it shows you that these are molecules. So they are made up of atoms. And so normally at this time, I would point to the periodic table and remind you that molecules are made from the atoms, which are in the periodic table. We will also be looking at the molecules of bliss, the molecules of meditation. And finally, the last 2 weeks, we will be looking at metabolism. So this is the Krebs cycle. And whenever I go to a doctor, I haven't been to a doctor in years and years, and they would ask what my degree was in, and I would say biochemistry, and they would all say the same thing. Oh, the Krebs cycle. So one of my goals is that you don't say that. You go, oh, the Krebs cycle. The Krebs cycle is awesome. And this is a picture I put in. This is because it turns out these molecules have been known for thousands of years as sacred geometry. And so there are squirrels in my backyard. Put her outside. And so my dog, you might hear Shanti, is very sweet and very tiny, and she protects us from the squirrels. All right. So we're going to start with the elephant in the kitchen. And so we all have an elephant in our kitchen. And there it is, the caution sign. I don't actually have bread in my kitchen, but are carbohydrates friends or foes? And that's what we're going to be exploring this week. And in my kitchen, carbohydrates are some of our best friends. That's a picture of Joey. Joey's my son, for those of you who haven't been in my class, and Joey's been sitting in on this class, so he's been my technology guru as I'm learning how to teach to you in this environment. And so that's, Joey's much older than that. So four-year-olds are techno savvy also, but Joey is gonna be 22 next week, and he's enjoying his carbs. But this is the myth that is out there. This is definitely the bacon. Come on, really? So the problem is not the bun. The problem is the bun and everything else, because that's a highly processed bun. So what's the elephant in your kitchen? Thankfully, I have peanut butter now. For like a week, I couldn't find peanut butter in the stores, but we have it again. All right, so let's talk about carbohydrates. So what are carbohydrates? Cookie Monster is wondering. So in case you don't know who Cookie Monster is, he's a Muppet, a puppet from Sesame Street, and he loves his cookies. And so he shows up all over your homework set. And I just went with it for the whole term. So you'll become good friends with Cookie Monster. So carbs are breads. breads are amazing. You can make them with all types of grains. And carbs are your vegetables. Vegetables, you should all eat lots of vegetables. By the way, whoever did this photo, that's why I kept it, eggs are not a vegetable. They are not a carbohydrate. And I found this picture amusing, and that's why I included it. But you know what's in there? There's ginger. I'm pretty sure that's ginger. What an awesome topic that would be. Legumes. She eats legumes every day. So the fourth video take of carbohydrates is my legume slide. So we'll come back and talk about them. But so many different. These are your beans. So lentils. These are my favorite down here, the orange ones. So the Himalayan lentils and chickpeas. I love chickpeas. And these are some of the ancient grains. So I'm pretty sure this is quinoa. One of them is probably teff. Oh, one of them is barley. Me and barley don't do well. And that's what I love to make is curry. I do it without the sour cream, but we'll talk about that in a couple weeks. And then fruit. Fruit is definitely a carbohydrate, and fruit is your best friend. And we'll talk about that at the end of this slideshow. And the problem with carbohydrates is this is also carbohydrates. This is purely highly processed pure sugar. And that is little 6-year-old Joey enjoying Halloween. And you know what? Kids should enjoy Halloween, but they don't need to eat all that candy. This was the year he had 3 different costumes. And you all had a year when you had 3 different costumes. Oh, and these are carbohydrates, highly processed Pringles and M&Ms and Oreos. And these are carbohydrates. And it takes up 50% of your screen, because it turns out this is, for many people, almost 50% of their calorie intake a day. That many people drink a lot of soda. And the fact that some of us don't drink any soda, when you look at the average, it must be really high. And there's Cookie Monster, who's very adorable. All right. And what I needed to add about 2 or 3 years ago is this, because now people are addicted to Starbucks. And this is an interesting story. I just got off the phone with my mom, who's in New Jersey. And so New Jersey is on complete lockdown. And she couldn't believe, because you could hear the cars. I was on a walk and she could hear the cars going by, and she couldn't believe how many cars there were out. And I said, well, people are a little not aware of how serious this can be. And so she said, well, all your Starbucks are closed. And I said, no, you can still go to the drive-thru, because people need the sugar. Because that is not coffee if you look at it. It's some weird brown concoction. And this is the problem, that so many people don't even get it like that. They get all this other extra stuff too. And then we have some very wise presidential nutritional advice for you. So, this was Ronald Reagan. Declared that one of your servings of vegetables a day could be your French fries. And that was right before the supersizing. So this was not a serving of French fries back then. This, of course, would be 2 servings of vegetables. And then George Bush, and I believe it was the first George Bush, said that the ketchup you put on the fries also counted as a vegetable serving of day. So there you go. You got all your servings of vegetables right there. And oh, we don't want to let Barack Obama off here. His administration declared that lunch lady pizza was also a vegetable. I would highly disagree with all of them. And that is probably, and that is why we have obesity epidemic in this country. And hopefully you've all started watching one of those videos that I sent out, and they're at the end of this slideshow, so we'll talk about them. So before I get into carbohydrate structure, I just wanted to talk about how SAD is the standard American diet. And so in case you've never seen this acronym, this is one of my most favorite acronym. So standard S-A-D, SAD, our diet, the standard American diet, which everybody in the world wants to imitate now, is extremely sad. So this is from 2010. The census is happening right now, and so we'll get all new numbers. From the American Cancer Institute report, 9 out of 10 Americans do not meet the minimum requirement of vegetables. And this is a picture I found, and I love it, because 10 years ago when Joey and I flew to Nepal, we went on Korean Air, and you had the choice between the American meal or the Korean meal. And I went with the Korean meal. And this is pretty much what the two meals look like. This was the US meal, and it looked like how most Americans dress, which is beige. We just dress in brown. Well, not we, because I don't. And food in other cultures is very colorful. So they're kimchi and the vegetables. And if you ever get a fly in Korean Air, choose the Korean meal. 3 out of 4 Americans did not eat fruit in a given day. 75% didn't even have one piece of fruit. And there we go. Isn't that beautiful? Except I would contest that this is all highly processed carbs. And so just stick with the berries. Just stick with the berries. Look at those berries. All right. Oh, but let's not forget. There we go. The standard American diet. Don't see any fruit in that. Nope. So that would be part of the 75%. 96% do not eat greens or beans 3 times a week. I think it's one or the other. They put them in the same category. 98%, 98, did not eat the color orange. By the way, these Skittles do not count. The kimchi would, as would the apricots. But there's also so many other oranges besides oranges, pumpkins, butternut squash. Yeah, 2 times in a week, not twice a day, twice a week, you should eat the color orange. Lots of beta carotene. 99% did not eat at least 3 or 4 ounces of a whole grain, because we're eating the Wonder Bread. The Wonder and Wonder Bread was a processed out everything and then added 8 vitamins back in. And we now know vitamins, there are thousands upon thousands upon thousands of phytochemicals. The Union of Concerned Scientists estimate that if we met the minimum dietary guidelines, which these are very minimum, greens 3 times a week, you should be eating greens every single day. We would save 100,000 lives per year by eating healthier. And this is the part that amazed me, that in this healthy diet recommendation, 25% of your calories were discretionary. 25%, a quarter of your food is allowed to be junk. This. What this screen is showing, and I cannot understand how that can say, so what if we got rid of this 25% and just ate real? How many lives would we save? So the federal guidelines, they tell you 25% junk food is okay. This is a picture, one of those pie graphs, 51%. So people don't meet it because over 50% is highly processed, and even better, another 42% is highly processed animal products, that's where those eggs would belong also, as well as cheese and stuff, and 7% or less is a combination of fruits and vegetables. It is extremely sad. 95% of Americans exceed the 25%. And that's what this is showing, that this is the average American diet. And this is a picture. So I have pictures in my office. So if we do meet again, or if we meet to begin with, there I have some of the original pictures from 10 or 15 years ago. So this guy's been going around the world, and he gets a family, and he buys them their week's worth of groceries, and he takes a picture of them. And so this is the American. And so there we go. For all 4 of them, there is their serving of fruit for the whole week. There's like, that would be me eating grapes in like a 10-minute sitting. Look at all this juice. Look at all that. Look at all the chips. And that's their grapes. And I think those are tomatoes. It's really hard to tell. Oh, look, we have a processed fake milk coffee mate, though. Oh, and each boy, growing boy, they got their lunch lady pizza. So they're set. Young children between the ages of 2 to 8 that met this guideline. Want to guess how many? Go ahead, just throw out numbers. I can hear you. All right, 1 in 1,000. Young children in this country met the guideline of having only 25% of their diet as junk food. This is what our children are eating. So we had 95% of Americans, 5% of Americans are meeting it, yet with children it's 0.1%. So as small as children. This looks a European family. I don't know why. Oh, I guess because of the name of the food. Highly processed carbs again, but these look like really nice bread, probably from the local place. And I guess they got bottled water for some reason. And I'm thinking that's all dairy. They're really into their dairy there. Oh, look, they got their grapes. They got two apples for a family of five. Two apples for the whole week. Wow. You know, I never really looked at this picture before. What is this? Is this all dairy? This is all milk that's laying down on the table. This is what, and look at how grumpy these boys look. You know, these guys with their lunch lady pizza, they're pretty happy. All right. So these children, that one in a thousand, consume less than 12 spoons of sugar in a day. When you watch those movies, the recommendation is now that grown men should not eat more than, it's like 6 to 9. Grown. This is children have 999 out of 1,000. So 99.9% are having more than 12 spoons of sugar in a day. And here we go. Look at that. As we go further and further south towards the equator, we're getting more fruit. But the thing that's sad is as people are getting bigger kitchens, they're getting more processed food. So ask yourself, why is there an obesity epidemic that is becoming a pandemic? Yes, I used the word. It was already there. If you have refined carbs and animal protein, you're guaranteed you will have cancer. So the remedy, it's so simple. You don't have to count calories. You don't have to figure out how much iron you had in the day. You don't have to do any of that stuff. Oh, did I have enough of this B vitamin and that? Just keep it real. It's so simple. Keep it real. And aren't those beautiful, those grapes? All right. And the best part is it's low in carbs. So if you want to be like a vulture, go on the low carb diet. So here we go. So I was going to tell you when you have to take notes, and I will let you know. This page is just kind of an introduction. It's up to you if you want to write. So are they friends? Most plant matter is carbohydrate. That's just like a Trivial Pursuit question, but that makes sense, right? Our vegetables, our fruits, our grains, our legumes. So elements, remember the periodic table I referred to? What elements are in carbohydrates? Well, the name says carbo, so that must be carbon, and hydrate would refer to water, which is H2O. So it's made up of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. Only those three elements. So when John asked me, what does he need to remember? Carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. That's all there is on the first midterm, carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. So the general formula, this is more for your information. This is where the term carbohydrate came from. As they realized the ratio of carbon to water was always a 1-to-1. And we will see that as we start drawing them in the next couple of slides. Are carbohydrates water soluble? Well, those of you who had me for Chem 105, you should know this one. You should all be going, you betcha, with you. Yeah, there's lots of oxygens. There is one oxygen for every carbon. That is what a carbohydrate is. And oxygens pool. They love water. There's going to be H's on those oxygens, so we're going to see lots of hydrogen bonding. So these are very water soluble. And why that's important? You and I are water-based beings, and so carbohydrates are what our body wants. And again, how you know is all the oxygens. This is something that you already know. So what are some carbohydrates that you might have heard of? Glucose, sucrose, lactose, fructose. They're all ending with os, O-S-E. So anytime you see the ending O-S-E, it is a carbohydrate. There are a couple carbohydrates that do not end with O-S-E. There's one that we will run into too. Carbohydrates have one function, actually, in us, and that is they give us energy. And if you're not eating your carbs, you often will have very low energy. But this was a beautiful picture. Joey and I actually drove across the country 2 years in a row, and both years we stopped at this On our way home, this is only a couple hours from us here in Gresham. And the first year it was completely socked in, and we have a picture, but all you see are clouds. And so the next year we couldn't believe it. It was the perfect view of Mount Rainier. And Joey is trying to show some yoga pose. Oh, that must be dancer. So we're going to classify carbohydrates. So get that pencil and paper out and let's go for it. So there's little chubby 10-year-old Joey. And let's take a look at molecular structure of carbs. This is Bryce Canyon. This was spring break Joey was 10. And if you've never been to Bryce Canyon, it is so beautiful. It was spring break. It's at 8,000 or 9,000 feet. And thankfully there was a hotel because we had been camping the whole trip and the campground was under like 2 feet of snow. And we were camping in the back of our van at the time. So we did get to go snowshoeing. We got a great deal because they were closing the next day, even though there was tons of snow. And so it's interesting because this is spring break is just ending now. And it's a very different kind of spring break. All right. So carbs are what's called a polyalcohol. You don't need to know that word. An alcohol is an OH group. And so every carbon, as I mentioned, has an oxygen. So if you look at this picture, every carbon has an oxygen. And there's always one carbon that's special. And that is a carbon that has, those of you got Chem 105, you're also going to have an aldehyde group, and that is this carbon-oxygen double bond, or a ketone. And the difference is aldehyde, it's at number one here. And over here on the right, the double bonded O is at carbon number two, so counting down 1, 2. So if the double bonded O is not at the top carbon, it's somewhere in the middle, it is a ketone. And so how we name them when they're carbohydrates is aldose, the one on the left, and a ketose for the one on the right. So an aldose, again, if it's at the end, the carbonyl is what it's called. So the double bonded O is at the end or the top. Got it? Thumbs up? Seeing everybody's thumbs up? Thank you. All right, now we're going to classify them by the number of carbons. So processing, or you're going, what? Hopefully you're at the middle one, you're processing. So if you look at each of these pictures, I'm pointing with my finger and none of you can see my finger. All right, this has 3 carbons. The second one has 4 carbons, 5 carbons, 6 carbons. So that's what we call them. A triose, 3 carbons, tetrose, pentose, and a hexose. We're gonna be working mostly with hexoses and there's gonna be one special pentose that we're gonna see today. All right, did you could write that down, but we're gonna do examples. So this is another term before we get into ones that you're going to be able to draw out is we have to review this term chiral. So if you did take 105, we saw this word once and most of you went, what is that? And then we never really saw it. And I said, oh, we'll deal with it in 106. So now we're dealing with it. So the key is this, you can write it down. It is an asymmetrical carbon, meaning it has 4 different groups. So this carbon has a chlorine, bromine, fluorine, hydrogen. And then this that behind the young lad here is a mirror and you flip it and it mirrors. And you cannot superimpose them. So the fluorines are sticking out at you and the dotted line to the hydrogen is sticking behind you. And if you try to lift the one up and line up the chlorine and the fluorine sticking out at you, the hydrogen and bromine don't. So the chiral carbon creates what are known as stereoisomers. So the word isomer is something is different. So they still have the same atoms, but something's different. A stereoisomer is just a special type of isomer that we're gonna be dealing with today. All right, you can always stop me at any time. It's just another example. You don't have to write it down. We're going to do examples together in a moment. But these are mirror images. Here's some more. Tweedledee and Tweedledum apparently are mirror images through the looking glass. I did not know that. DNA is chiral. So we have, There's right-handed helixes and right-handed, this one of them is an alpha helix. Your hands are a mirror image, your feet, you can go ahead and try it right now. Your feet mirror each other, your hands mirror each other. So if you hold your palms, your fingers all mirror each other, and then you put one palm on top of the other hand and your fingers don't line up, your thumbs are sticking off. Whereas a baseball is actually a mirror image. This is up here is a picture of amino acids, and so we'll see this again. And these are a bunch of really cool pictures of, I just try to, every slideshow, also try to find inspiration maybe for one student out of all of you who might be interested in finding one of these topics. So down here, this is spearmint, as in the gum mint. There's all different types of mints, but this is spearmint, and its mirror image makes the flavor of caraway, which is totally different. And so your tongue, it fits into your taste buds different. The taste of orange and lemon, the only difference apparently is a mirror image of the molecule. A lot of drugs are just mirror images, and only one of them is bioactive usually. So ibuprofen is an example of that. So ibuprofen actually has both the mirror images in there, and only one of them can be used by your body. Whereas naproxen, I believe, actually has only the bioactive one, and so it works much faster. All right, we're gonna play a game. Which carbons are chiral? So this game is in your homework, so I would not try to write these down. I would just play along with me and get the idea of how to do it, and then when you do your homework, you get to do it again. So carbon A is not chiral, and it is not chiral because there's two hydrogens. And the rule to be chiral is you have to have four different things. If we look at carbon B is also no. And that is because it has a CH3, which is called a methyl, and another CH3. So it has two of the same thing. Oh, C is looking good. We got a CH3, we have a chlorine, we have a hydrogen, we have an OH. So that is a yes, four different groups. And D is also a yes. And this one, we have an OH, we have an H, the H would be sticking up above, but they often show it there. We have a CH3, and on the left side, we have two carbons versus just one. And so that makes it different. So that's why I wrote down here, the CH3 is not the same as the ethyl group. All right, we're gonna do a bonus round. You ready? So, A. Nope, has two hydrogens. How about on B? Nope, has the methyl. See the methyl on each side? C is a nope. Well, this is looking like a really simple midterm question, right? It's probably right where it's from. D would be your answer. We have four different groups around it, and that makes it chiral. So that's all that word means. How it's going to be used is with this word, enantiomers. So you just have to recognize this word. Enantiomer is mirror images. And so this picture is wonderful. These are enantiomers. So the bottom carbon is not chiral. It has two hydrogens. And so when we draw carbohydrates out, we're gonna be seeing the bottom one, we just write CH2OH. And the top one, this is the aldehyde position. This is that double bonded O, that's what it's showing here. And so this H is connected to the carbon, and then the O would be on the carbon, because the H can't never mix two bonds. And so CHO is a shorthand way of writing aldehydes. You're gonna see that on a little video clip we have in a few slides. So an enantiomer is a mirror image that you can't superimpose. These middle two carbons, the pink carbons, are chiral. So the chiral carbons are gonna flip. So pretty straightforward. Again, you don't have to write all this down. You can just appreciate it. So which chirals are carbon? The pink ones. They have four different groups. The aldehyde, again, is never ever chiral. The bottom is never chiral, and the pink ones are. And this is trying to show you these are not flat molecules. They're actually zigzagging. And because of that, as these OHs and Hs are actually sticking up towards us like in a V, and the other side, they also are. So if you tried to flip the molecule and line it up, then they would be going down. So, all right, the disastromers. So they're actually diastereomers. if you look, that blue carbon and the pink carbons are chiral, but the blue carbon did not flip. So it is not an enantiomer, but they are still related. And so you have the same number of carbons. It's still an allose, but it's not a mirror image because not all the chiral carbons flipped. So this is a disastermer. We're gonna take it one more step and we're gonna classify as D and L. So D stands for your right hand, dextero, and L stands for levo, left hand. So if you look at the chiral carbon furthest from the aldehyde, so here's my aldehyde, and the chiral carbon furthest is this number 4 pink one. If the OH points to the right, it is D, dextero, and if it points to the left, it is L. We're going to do a number of practices in the next few moments. Only D's are bioactive, so you can always back me up if you didn't like how fast I move. All right. A and B are the enantiomers. They mirror image each other. By the way, you're never, ever going to draw one like this. You can write it as CHO, or you can show the double bond up above the carbon, but you do not write it like this. This horrifies me every time. And if I asked you how B and C are related, so they both have 4 carbons. This is a shorthand way, and we're all going to be doing this in a few moments, of showing the chiral carbons. So you just show a cross here. So they're like little Charlie Brown Christmas trees. And here you go. A and C are also diastereomers. So they're tetroses. We're going to classify as L and D. So this is me cringing seeing the aldehyde. We're going to look at carbon number 3. This guy here is going to the right. The OH goes to the left. OH goes to the right. So it's a D, an L, and a D. Got it? All right, thumbs up. So we're going to practice. You don't need to write this down. Just play along with me. We're going to be writing some down in a few moments. All right, here we go. Is it an aldose or a ketose? Well, one on the left looks like an aldehyde, so aldose. And this one is a ketose, so it's at the second carbon. How many carbons? Well, the first one has 3, so that's a triose. And the second one, the one over on the right, has 6. So that would be a hexose. So hexa is 6. And how many chiral carbons? So on the triose, just the one here. And on the hexose, top and bottom, we have to rule out. And the carbonyl, so there's just 3. 1, 2, 3. And D or L, they're both D. So the OH points to the right, the furthest OH. And to draw the enantiomer, you would just flip the chiral. So this one would flip it. We're going to do that on the next page. So the answers were D, aldotriose, and D, ketohexose. All right, you've got this. And you can do a happy dance because you're like, I can do this. I'm doing something. I'm doing anything now other than cleaning my closets. All right, that's me. And there's the gnome that Jamie gave me. Hooray! There's the elephant on the chalkboard in the kitchen, and we're gonna play the video. Oops, sorry.
Hello.
Can you not hear me?
Dr. Joy Sherpa, for those who haven't met me, this is our first video together. You've heard my voice throughout the slideshow, and I'm teaching you structures today of carbohydrates. This is a lot of chemistry the first day, because this is biochemistry. So for some of you in organic chemistry, there's gonna be a lot of review. This should be familiar. But to draw an aldohexose, draw straight line, and then we do 4 across here.
All right, so Joey's telling me it's fine. I don't think it is.
I call
this
Charlie
is one of the videos
history.
I did the first day, and somehow they saved in double time. I'm drawing an aldohexose, so you can.
H2OH. We draw this carbon like this because it's not chiral. It has 2 hydrogens. The top of our tree needs a decoration, so we're going to put a double bonded O. That's our aldehyde. That's what makes it an aldo. And if you want, because you're like, oh, it's going to fall over, you can put the H there. I'll show you a couple different ways in this brief video. Now, each of the other carbons also gets an oxygen, but it's going to be an OH.
I'm talking in double time, so you
write
decorate the top
OH
of the tree with the double bonded
and
O.
And then the next two, we can actually write on the other ones. An HO. I'll write hoe and hoe.
When you write it over here on the left side,
you write it as a hoe. And when you write it on the right side, you're going to write it as an O. You always want to show the oxygen attached to the carbons. And these are carbons. So we'll go ahead and number them. So this is carbon 1. This is carbon 2. Carbon 3.
So my pink dots
carbon
are the
4.
Carbons.
Carbon 5, and then this is carbon 6. That's going to be important for some things we're going to do in
the
lab.
The crosshairs are the chiral
ones. Okay. Alright. So, aldohexose. Which carbons are chiral? Well,
which carbons are chiral?
So 2, 3, 4, and 5 are chiral. And that's because they have four different things. Something above, something below, and the OH in the empty space.
Wow,
is
I always talk this fast.
You absolutely write the H in, but it's
some of you are going, yes.
What we're
going
to do is
Joey's looking at me saying yes.
So, Charlie Brown Christmas Street, four crosshairs.
So just mirror.
And you flip your chiral positions. The top and bottom don't change. So the base part of the street is still CH2OH. And our top, it's up to you. You can mirror it. It doesn't matter. It's not chiral. So you can show the double bond O. You can show the H. You don't have to show the H. I'm feeling you need to show the H. That's the enantiomer. All the chiral positions flip. So the OH becomes an HO. All right. Now we're going to do one more. Move us over a little bit. And that would be.
Well, now you can see the
diastereomer.
He's trying to tell me to slow down.
This is an isomer. It's still going to be an aldohexose.
So an isomer, that is not the mirror image.
We're still going to have the same top. Now, I want to show you a different way. You can also write an aldehyde by writing CHO. CHO is an aldehyde shorthand. Carbons make four bonds. So we can see that here. Here we can see this carbon, the double bond. Hydrogens always make one bond. So that oxygen must be on the carbon. And for the carbon to have four total bonds, it would be a double bond O. So that is the other acceptable way of showing it. So you can show the double bond there.
The
you don't have to show that hydrogen. You can show that single bond to the hydrogen. All right, it is still an aldehyde, and it's still a hexo. So four crosshairs. And a diastereomer just means we're going to do anything except what we did. So you can put all O's. You can put all hoes, you can put oh, ho, oh, ho, 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 oh, ho. Anything
yeah, so
but these original, too.
But so the OH is any way you want, except the original way or its mirror image.
Four is the number of chiral carbons, is 16. Yeah. There are 16 ways we can draw an aldohexose. We are not going to do that.
Possibilities.
There are 8 pairs of enantiomers, and then there's 8 different ways you can show. In those 8, there's 8 different ways you can show the O's and the O's. All right, we can do one more thing with this picture. 2 more things, actually. We're going to show D's and L's. The furthest chiral carbon, which is this guy, the special, the furthest chiral carbon from the carbonyl tells you if it's D or L. If it's pointing to the right, it's D. If it's pointing to the left, it's L. The disastromer I drew, it was a D. So I classified them. D aldohexose, L aldohexose, D aldohexose.
All right. All right. Well, actually, no, we'll go on. So plain polarized light. The reason this is here is enantiomers have all the same physical properties. Again, you don't have to write this down. You're going to remember it. Their melting point, there's one question in the homework. Everything's the same about them, except how they rotate plain polarized light. So if you have the light source, all the light's coming off in all different chaotic directions, and you put it through a polarized lens, like they do on glasses, it makes all the light go through in one direction. So now we have monochromal light. And then if you run it through an optically active solution, which is has a sugar in it, anything that's chiral, it will rotate the light either to the left or to the right. It doesn't have anything to do with the L and D. It was just how they drew it. And I think I have one more. There is something called a racemic mix, and it means it has equal molar amounts of D and L. So if you have an equal amount of the D and the L, the light won't rotate. It cancels. They cancel each other out. All right. The thing, in my opinion, that's more important than that is only one of the enantiomers is bioactive. So this is epinephrine, which is chiral. It has a chiral carbon, and only one of them will fit into its receptor in your body. And they showed the wrong one, which is amazing. All right. So one more word. The words vocabulary is fascinating. This is an aldohexose again, and we can draw two different ways. So we're going to see another video in a moment. So in our body, they're not going to be stretched out in this linear way. They're going to be cyclic, like these hexagons. And it's this position. So we're going to see an oxygen, and the position next to the oxygen, if the OH is down, we call it alpha. And if the OH is up, we call it beta. And it's really easy to remember. It was some of my students like 10 years ago or more, maybe. Alpha looks like a fish, and fish swim down in the ocean, and beta looks like a butterfly or a bird or a bee buzzing up in the sky. So beta is up, alpha is down. So we're going to draw these.
Hello, we are back. We're going to draw a hexagon. And
I'm wearing my tear.
I'm making the hexagon. Very important. Charlie Brown Christmas tree.
So we're going to draw the same one. I'm purposely going slow because
Cal is meditating very peacefully between the tree pose, the lotus.
Get on to the moment of yoga.
Apple. Eating apples every day. Did you make your healthy change? Oh, we get to talk about that. We get to that today.
So draw your Charlie Brown Christmas tree. Decorate.
Remember to decorate Charlie Brown's Christmas tree. And do an O and then a ho, ho, and then an O. Alright, we all want the same thing. So you end up with the same hexagon as me. Now we're getting a number. One, two,
so
three.
Number. Always four, number your carbons.
Five.
Students should get this right. They number their carbons.
So, always starting at the top down on our Charlie Brown Christmas tree. The end, the aldehyde gets to be number one. If we do a ketone, the ketone's always closest to the end. That's the number one. So we have six carbons, so we're going to make a hexagon. In your hexagon, you're going to always have an oxygen in that position. You're going to get really good drawing hexagons this week. You'll get to draw a couple. Right. And then you're going to make a line at each place on your hexagon. And now we're going to number our hexagon. So one, two, three.
Again, make sure you always number.
Same as me, that position next
to oxygen.
Number
one is always right there next to it in your hexagon.
And what that six means,
it's always going to look like this.
That is the base of our Charlie Brown Christmas tree. That is our stage.
Number six is always a flag at the top. Wait a minute.
So number one, oh, it's not a double bonded O anymore because we did magic. And
here's the magic.
That's why this position, number one, can do an alpha or a beta. You guys want to do? Want to swim down today? Let's fly.
Alpha
Let's
swimming
fly.
Down, but I decided to do a beta.
And the birds and the butterflies.
I think the birds and the bees.
But this is a beta because at that number one position, the position next to the oxygen is pointing up.
And it's only
right?
that position.
It has a choice. And it is because it was this oxygen. Where it got the H from is this guy. So if you remember, the furthest chiral carbon, which is number five, right? We have these four chiral carbons across.
So the furthest chiral carbon,
Christmas tree.
That oxygen
is
that oxygen in the ring.
This oxygen in the ring. So at number five, we're not going to have an OH anymore. We're just going to leave it. Going to have this H that was on the side. This H came up and connected to that oxygen. The double bond broke. I could do it. And so that H is now this H. Now, do you need to know that? No. But somebody always asks me that question.
So you don't need to know that. Somebody always asks me.
What happens at the other positions?
But here's
turn
the trick.
Around the Christmas tree. Falls over.
The tree has to fall over.
It always falls to the right.
Always falls to the right.
It's a D. We're only going to draw hexagons for the D's because in nature, Mother Nature, all of our carbohydrates are D's. Interestingly, amino acids are L's on this planet, and our carbohydrates are D's. So it always falls that way. So number two.
that OH is now going to be down. And so we would show it down. But 3 and 4, they're going to be pointing up. So 3 and 4. Wow, I did that last time too. And there's the reason I keep doing that. Because glucose, 3 is up and 4 is down. So at least now I know in my head why I keep doing that. When we show the OH on the number 4, whether it's up or down, in this case it has to be up because when the Charlie Brown Christmas tree fell over, it would be up. But when it is pointing up like that or down, we like to write it as a HO when it's on the left side of our hexagon. In the ring, I don't care if you write this as an O. Some students would like to write it as a HO, and that's fine. As long as you show the bond to the oxygen. All right. Which is great, unless you want to do another practice, which we will do in a few slides. All right. Until then, have a magical, magical day. Hello.
All right. We don't need to watch that again, but you can always go back and watch it again. You can stop and rewind. I'm going to keep going. So I apologize for talking over it. I forgot I had the headphones on and I had taken my headphones off. So you could hear me, I hope. Or if not, let me know. And on the future ones, I will fix that issue. So this is just to remind you, these are called Hawthorne projections. I don't know if runs the word. I call them anomers. So when it's down, it's alpha, the OH. At the position next to the oxygen. We don't write the carbons in. This is just a picture I did. I don't know why. And then this is beta. The beta looks like a butterfly or a bird, and the OH points up. All right, so we're gonna practice, just like I said. So you're gonna take notes real quick, write down the questions, because we're gonna cut to a video. So you're gonna make an aldohexose, and actually, this is just telling you, so your aldohexose course has 6. So carbons number 3 and 5 are gonna be O's, and the other chiral carbons will be on the left side, they'll be HOs. Draw an enantiomer, and then you can try the alpha. Now you're gonna do an aldopentose, and a pentose means you're only gonna do 5 carbons. Just make sure these go 3 and 4 to the right. And give yourself space. You don't have to write down, especially my typo, because I do it all in the next slide on a video. The last one is the ketohexose. So you can pause me if you want to write all that stuff down. So here we go. Here's me.
Hello, we're back again. All right, so we're on the practice page. I want you to draw an aldohexose. So you draw your Christmas tree, put your base in. I'm hoping you pause before you hit play again. So you tried this on your own, and it told us to put 3 and 5 to the right. So that would mean 2 and 4 were O's. So usually, in fact, always, it's going to be where I give you this part, and then you do the next step. But this was the best way that I could explain it in that slide. To do the enantiomer, you guys know what to do. You draw your 4 crosshairs. The top you can just write CHO. Bottom you can do CH2OH, and then you mirror. So we're gonna have an O, and then we have a HO, and then we have an O, and then we have a HO. My first one is D, my second one is an L, my enantiomer. Right, and then we're going to do a hexagon. The hexagon is of the original picture. You're not going to do hexagons of L. L are not biologically active. That was just showing you what an L looks like. All right, number 6 is pointing up. And let's see, I want to do alpha or beta. Oh, we're going to do alpha. And then we're going to do a so the OH points down at number 1. So that's my alpha position. Points down like the fish swimming down below. At number 2, so going back to my original, when my tree falls over, always falls to the right. My number 2 is pointing up. My number 3 is pointing down. And again, typically number three, they write in the hexagon as a ho. You can write it as a ho or an O. That doesn't matter to me. And then number four is going to point up. Number four is typically written as a ho in the hexagon. And that's our answer. All right. We're going to move on because now we're going to do a keto hexose. So you should have hopefully been able to do it. The base is still CH2OH. The difference is number two is the ketone. So this is a keto hexose. And then number one has two hydrogens. So the top and bottom of our tree look the same. And then in the thing I said, oh, I skipped to the keto hexose. I apologize. All right, let's move over here and we'll come back.
This is my first day videotaping.
We do the old opening. So, top of our tree is our decorated however you like. You can write a CHO, you can put the double bond over there. And this time there's only three crosshairs because it's a pentose. So, one. Two, three, four, five. There's only five carbons. And I want three and four. All the crosshairs have an OH. I'm just telling you in this case, three and four are to the right. And then that would mean number two was the ho. All right, if you did your enantiomer, you would flip it. So two would be the O on the right, and three and four would be to the left. I'm gonna show you the pentagon. So both of these pictures are going to make pentagons. The eldopentose, because there's only five carbons, means a pentagon. So you draw a pentagon with an oxygen at the top. And then one, two, three, four, number five, the base of the tree sticks off, CH2OH. All right, number one is our beta position, and so that's my OH. So that's beta, flying up in the sky like a bird. And just a reminder, that one was a double bonded O. That's why it has a choice of going up or down, because it picks up this furthest hydrogen. All right, when our tree falls, again, it always falls to the right. Number two is going to point up, and number three is going to point down. Number four, we don't worry about, because number four, its oxygen was the one that went in the ring. All right, let's look at the keto hexose. And my board's getting really well used here, so hopefully you can still see it. All right, so on this one, I wanted three and five to be to that side. So number four would be the ho. The eldohexoses are the most common. I want you guys to see a picture so you know what the pentagons look like. All right, just try and get everything in the picture. There's not going to be a lot of these things. All right, it also goes to a pentagon. And the reason why is the carbonyl is the position next to the oxygen. So this is number two, three, four, five, six. Of course, the base of the tree is sticking up above. Oh, and number one was not a chiral position either, so it's going to be sticking off. Now, I believe I wanted to do an alpha. Yes. So, number two was our special position. Alpha means the OH points down. We still need to put number one on. It would be then pointing the other way. That is number one. You can rewind and watch me as many times as you want. But we usually do eldohexoses, but this is how you would do the pentagons because you will run into them. All right, our Christmas tree falls which way? To the right. You're all saying it at home. I can hear you. Falls over to the right. So number three,
is going to point down. Number four is going to point up. When you write it, you can write it as an O or a HO. It doesn't matter, as long as you're showing it sticking to the oxygen, not the hydrogen. And then number five doesn't get an OH. This oxygen is this oxygen that's in the ring. Questions? Always a lot of questions. But you'll have to write down your question and come to my live office hours, and I'll do my best. That's all we can ask. Let's all do our best. Thank you so much. I hope you enjoy whichever video you chose to watch. All the documentaries are really awesome. And I'll see you next time. Bye. Hello, we're back again. All right, so we're on the...
Didn't we already do this? We're going to skip this. Do you guys need to do another hexagon? So this is what I was referring to, is the documentaries you need to watch. So this is for the second lab. Your first lab was the egg dyeing. That number you've actually emailed me and have been doing it. And if you have questions, you can email me. And they are due. So lab one is due, I guess, the day after Easter, or the day after Easter, and then the documentary. And so the sugar film, I gave you, like, you're going to write about two paragraphs. You can just type it in an email and send it to me. And so it's just your thoughts. You can do three things you learned. So the first one I watched was Fed Up. I've been assigning these for years, never watched them. And then I didn't have, while I was making Joey's dinner, we watched Fed Up. It was actually really good. It was the first one we watched, and it was newsy because it was Katie Couric. And then we watched the sugar, that sugar film, and I was laughing so hard, and it has all the information in there, but he's really funny. And so I actually recommend that one just because I think laughter is awesome. Sugar coated was the hardest one for us to find. It was really sciencey, and those of you who love conspiracy theory stuff, they do a really good job. They talk about the whole conspiracy cover up in all of them, but Sugar Coated really goes into it. I actually recommend, if you have nothing else to do, which now you all do because you're in school again, all three of them are really good. And I also recommend watching it with somebody in your house because they have nothing to do. You're busy now, but and tell me what they thought of it too when you write up. So this is, about half of you don't know me, but this, yes, it is college, but this is not like I'm grammatically checking you. Just tell me what your thoughts are. Just say, oh, wow, I didn't know that. It was really funny, and this is what I learned. Don't just tell me it was funny in three words. Tell me what you learned. All right, I think, let's see if that's it. All right. I'm going to stop recording, and there I am again, and I'm sorry if I talked over my recording. I forgot it was on my headphones, and I took them off to talk to you all, and I always forget to talk to the camera. I hope you all have a magical day.